Hey everyone! One of the questions people ask me most frequently on this channel is why I don't upload episodes of Tea Talk more often. And since episode 4 of Tea Talk just went up a few days ago, I thought I would take the opportunity while I still have the Premiere project on hand to put together a video and do my best to explain to those of you who are asking exactly why it takes so long to upload episodes of Tea Talk, and why the production of these videos in particular is so complicated. Now, the last video I made detailing my production process was over 2 hours long. I'm going to try and avoid that being the case this time. I'm going to keep things as concise and brief as I possibly can, but there's a lot to talk about, so let's launch right into it here. Once again, what you're looking at is the Premiere project for episode 4 of Tea Talk. And those of you who actually did watch that 2-hour video are probably looking at this thinking, wait a minute, something doesn't add up here. You said it took 6 weeks to make this episode of Tea Talk. How come all I see is one video track, 3 audio tracks, and a bunch of subtitles? In particular, those of you who did watch that 2-hour-long video might be thinking of this edit, which I showed toward the end. This is actually an opening edit from one of the episodes of the Mega Man Legends After Hours videos that I did with my friend Nick from Bitterbits. Now, looking at this edit, it's very obvious that it took a long time and has a great deal of complexity. I suspect some of you are probably thinking, well, wait a minute. How come the episode of Tea Talk that you're showing us right now does not look like this? So, let's come back to the project at hand here. Unfortunately, not all production processes are created equal, and that is especially true comparing the project you're looking at now to the edit that you just saw. The Premiere project here unfortunately does not tell the whole story, and although it is only a very small project just to look at it, it does indeed represent 6 weeks worth of work. So let's launch right into it, and I will explain from beginning to end the process through which I record an episode of Tea Talk. And for future reference, because I'm sure I'm going to be pointing people back to this video sometime in the future, this is true not only of just the Tea Talk series, but also of pretty nearly any video I might happen to make, which requires this level of complexity. The first thing I do is record all of the actual footage. That's this, everything shown up in this window here. This is the video footage. Now, for Tea Talk, I record this with a digital camcorder, which already is substantially different from the process whereby I record episodes of Let's Plays or anything I might happen to do that involves just recording video games. When I'm recording a Let's Play, I can do that right here in my office without having to go anywhere or spend any additional money. I have all of my equipment already set up. I have my computer, my consoles, my TV, keyboards. Everything is all hooked up and ready to record. So while that can sometimes take a substantial amount of time, typically I can get 2 or 3 episodes of a given Let's Play recorded in an evening if I have enough free time. In contrast, something like an episode of Tea Talk, especially one that requires me to travel in order to record something, just getting the footage alone can take several days if I'm unlucky, and that's definitely the case here. First of all, I had to record a certain amount of this footage here in my office, which is what you're looking at now. Then I had to record the actual footage at the Millerton store, which required that I make a trip out to Connecticut. Now, obviously, this is not something I would have been able to do if it were just for the sake of visiting the Harney & Sons store. I was fortunate enough to be able to make this stop on my way home to Berlin from E3. So that, more than anything, is what actually facilitated my ability to get to this location and record this footage. Once all of the footage is recorded and I have everything I need in order to begin laying the framework for the episode, I then import all of the footage to Adobe Premiere here, mount it in a project, arrange it, add all of the transitions, cut it, splice it, shorten it, do whatever is necessary in order to get the footage ready for recording the voiceovers, adding the music, and all of the other steps that come after that in the editing process. So let's zoom back in here. Now, you might not think it to look at this very simple shot, and I'm going to enlarge this, I think, so that everyone can see it. This is the scene on which all episodes of Tea Talk open. And it looks fairly simple. It looks like anyone could just slap a camera in a corner and record this, right? Well, unfortunately, no, that's not the case. My office is normally very dimly lit. I like to keep the lights low because it's more relaxing, and I also just dislike bright, glaring light. It hurts my eyes. I like it to be nice and warm and comfortable and homely, which is why I have the salt rock lamp here in the background, as well as the quartz lamp under my TV. And it's also why, when I record episodes of Tea Talk, I actually have my tea light lit and a pot of tea on the burner. I like the flickering light from the candle just to add a little bit of additional warmth to the shot. It's one of those artistic touches that I don't think you really notice consciously, but that really helps add to the atmosphere, I think. And a lot of care goes into setting up the shot so that things like the lamps are visible and can actually contribute their unique and subdued and warm light. But unfortunately, that's not always enough, and I have to aim much more high-powered lamps at the background, things like the NES and various other elements, so that everything in the shot is visible and there aren't too many shadows getting in the way and obscuring things and just looking terrible. So setting up the lamps and getting the angle of the light correct can take as much as 20 minutes sometimes, and after that, I then have to set up the camcorder itself. The camcorder gets set up on a tripod, and I have to move a lot of furniture around in order to do that. There's not a lot of space in here, and I was actually just given by a colleague and longtime friend of mine a new bed, which is considerably larger than my old one, so there's even less room to move around in here and to work with positioning of cameras. You might also be noticing that this table is bigger than my previous one. And I didn't have a chance to talk about this in the episode of Tea Talk itself, but my previous tea table was cheap and flimsy and ultimately ended up falling apart. So I purchased this new one, which is working out much better. It's larger and a lot more sturdy. But unfortunately, it's more difficult to get the camera angle positioned on it so that everything on the table is visible and properly centered, without obscuring too much of the background, because I like people to be able to see the NES. I like to emphasize that, yes, I love tea, but I also love video games, and people just finding this video out of the ether are not necessarily going to know that if they don't see some context for it. I also like people to be able to see my microphone stand and headphones and equipment in the background so that it's clear that I'm not just using some cheap $10 USB mic and that kind of thing. It's just sort of, I guess, a window into my life that I think a lot of people might have some interest in, just because I tend to be very secretive, even though I'm right out here in the public eye. And I try to show that as much as I can. And all of that, again, goes into the amount of time it takes to find the correct camera angle just for this one freaking shot on which the episode opens. And once I've got all of this set up, by the time all is said and done, it takes sometimes an hour and a half, 2 hours, once all of the lighting is arranged and all of that stuff is done. So once I have this shot, I'll then record 10 or 15 minutes of just this so that I can do voiceovers over it, on top of it, really, and add whatever commentary I might need to add without having to worry about running out of footage. Then I have to usually, depending upon what I'm actually trying to show, I'll have to pick up the camera, move around the room with it, and record other things, like this close-up of the burner, which is a process I then have to repeat with any additional clips that I need to cut in. So arranging all of this in the Premiere project and then adding all of the transitions, making sure everything is in the correct order and that the clips are trimmed to the right length so that I'm showing only what I want to show and not getting tons of basically dead footage where there's no commentary and there's nothing going on camera, that takes some time as well. So that's the first step. Once I've recorded all of the footage, be it from my office or on location, once all of that is set up and arranged in Premiere, Then I can sit down and start working on the voiceovers and the music. So before anything else, I guess, let's deal with one thing at a time and start with the voiceovers. I've talked a little bit before about the process I use to edit my audio. Down here, everything in the audio 2-track, this is all voice commentary. And as you can see, it's not just one continuous file, it's broken up into a large number of different sections. The reason for that is because if I am not satisfied with something, or if I make a mistake, I will go back and retake it. So what happens is, invariably, a truck or a motorcycle goes by while I'm in the middle of my commentary, or I sneeze, or cough, or my throat suddenly dries out, or the neighbors start making noise, and I have to stop recording and start all over again. So each one of these little clips is a different take where I had to stop recording the audio, start all over, then reposition it so that it flowed seamlessly from where I initially cut it. As to the number of times I have to do that, it is enormous. Over here in the media bin, you can see the clips that actually ended up being used. And let's scroll down here a little bit. So, once again, these are only the ones that actually made it into the project. However, here in the folder for the project itself, this also contains all of the rejected tracks. So let's take a closer look here. You'll see that the tracks have a designation of audio 1 underscore whatever, 1 underscore 12 or 18 or 23. So the audio 1 refers to the track in the project where that clip was recorded. So if it says audio 1, it was recorded here in the audio 1 track. The number after the underscore is the actual take, so that's the number of times that a recording was made in that track. Scrolling down through this list, we will see that in audio 1 alone, I ended up recording over 60 takes. And the same for audio 2, I ended up recording, let's see, further and further down here, 63 takes in audio 2. So a total of upwards of 120 retakes just for the voice commentary in this video. That takes time, and it's very tedious, and frankly very frustrating. When a motorcycle goes by or a truck goes by, and I'm tearing my hair out because I have to start all over again. So I have to chip away at it and just record bit by bit, section by section. It's very time-consuming, to say the least, and that's not even beginning to touch upon the music. So the music is down here in audio 3. Now, I appreciate very deeply the compliments that some of you offered on my choice of music for this video, and I'm not trying to garner additional compliments in explaining this, but I do want to make clear just how long and painstaking a process it is to find the right music for an episode of Tea Talk. Now, it's fairly simple narrowing it down for me in terms of instrumentation, because I prefer to use only piano music for these videos, this series. I feel like it really suits the theme best and is most appropriate for the subject matter. I did use a harpsichord rendition of the Velvet Room theme for the pilot episode, but that was a pilot. It was really just experimental, and I was trying out that style and just seeing if anybody was interested enough in it for me to be able to actually justify continuing to make it. It took me probably the better part of a week to find all of the music that I needed for this video. And a lot of that was searching for a piano rendition of the Dire Dire Docks theme from Super Mario 64 that was not recorded by somebody using their cell phone and filled with all kinds of background noise and just miserable stuff that it would have been hell for me to edit out in Adobe Audition. And that's another part of this process, is doing all the audio editing. Once I've got the commentary recorded, I then have to do the processing, which is done in this program. This is Adobe Audition. And I've talked about this before as well, but if you didn't watch the 2-hour long video, you probably haven't seen it. So just very briefly, this is the program I use to edit out background noise and other things that basically pollute the quality of my commentary audio. Things like the sounds of fans on my computer, or the much louder and more obnoxious fans on my PS4. Sometimes other background noise like crickets in the summer, or occasionally quieter vehicles going by like cars. Those I can edit out. Editing out trucks and motorcycles is a lot more difficult because those kinds of sounds are a lot more insidious, and eliminating them compromises the quality of my voice audio as well. So processing the audio in this program takes quite a bit of time. Fortunately, I don't have to process the music, but just finding it is miserable, and it was probably 3 or 4 days of searching for a good 2 to 3 hours a day before I finally found Michael Tai's piano arrangement of this theme. It took another couple of days for me to get in touch with him and get his permission for it and make sure that all of that was sorted out, at which point it was probably another couple of days before I found suitable piano tracks to fill in the rest of what I needed them for, which was another probably, 15 minutes of the video. And I ended up only using 2 tracks. I used a piano instrumentation of the auction house theme from Jidur, I think that's where it's used in the game, from the Final Fantasy VI piano collections. I also used a piano rendition from the Final Fantasy IX piano collections album of the Trino theme, which itself was already piano instrumental to begin with. Now, the Final Fantasy VI theme was only about, 3 or 4 minutes long at absolute most, but I ended up using it for a section of the video that spanned probably 9 minutes, 8 to 9 anyway. And I had to use a very particular technique in order to stretch it out for that period of time. Let's zoom in here a little bit, and we'll take a closer look at what exactly I did, because this was also very time-consuming. The section of the video for which I used this track was from right about here, all the way up to the point in the video where I switched to showing the restaurant. So, right about here. And again, this section of the video is a lot longer than the track that I used for it, so, well, what do I do? Ordinarily, if somebody is going to be lazy, they'll just loop the track from beginning to end. I don't like doing that because it's very obvious, and particularly in the case of the piano arrangements from the arrange albums of any video game, they tend to end on a flourish that is not conducive of leading into it again or leading out of it into another part of the track. So I used a very different technique wherein I took the whole track, cut up different parts of it, and then spliced them together end to end so that the track seemed longer and different parts of the track would play into one another seamlessly, without there being really any evidence that the track was being looped in full, because it was only being looped in part. Different parts of the track were being looped and then conjoined end to end, so that it was much more seamless without it being obvious that I had just looped it. And that's why there are different sections here. There's, I think in total, something like 5 or 6 different pieces of this track that I fit together. You have to make sure that the tracks are joined at exactly the right point to preserve the tempo without it being thrown off sync. So there's some fairly painstaking work that goes into that. And then where I use the Trino theme for this part of the video, I was able to get away with just using the track once from beginning to end. But in order to accomplish that, I had to cut and splice the video footage so that it was exactly long enough to cover the track. So a lot of editing, and in this case, the footage that I used for this part of the video, I had to spend quite a bit of time going through and prioritizing exactly what I wanted to use and what I could afford to spare to cut so that this section of the video footage would fit the music track. All of this takes a long time, and it's very particular and fiddly work. It's not the sort of thing that you can just slap together in an hour or two. This editing alone with the music took probably 3 or 4 days. So there's that. And on top of that, this is something that I have only had to deal with actually for this episode of Tea Talk, since I've never actually collaborated with anybody on one of these before. But in addition to getting permission from Mr. Tai to use his piano theme, I also had to contact Harney and Sons and obtain permission to film at their store. Because you don't just walk into one of these places, point a camera at somebody, and say, "All right, everybody, I'm filming you. Start answering questions." It's very, very bad form, very unprofessional, and not the way to win somebody's cooperation. So I contacted them well in advance, but I still don't think they really fully understood what I was trying to do until I actually got there, had my camcorder in hand, and was able to walk them through exactly what it was I was trying to accomplish and what I would need from them. And they were all very amenable to it, but they asked that their faces not be shown, which is why I had to cover them up with tins of tea. Some of you might have noticed in different parts of the video that I used basically images of tins of Harney and Sons tea to censor people's faces. And another thing that I had to do, I'm trying to find the subtitle here. I think it was this one. Yeah, it was. I had to re-upload the entire video, as some of you might have noticed when it first went live, because this subtitle was incorrect. This listed the tea that I was sampling as Jinshan, when it was in fact Junshan Yinsen. And I am not about to have any inaccuracies in this video after the amount of time and effort it took me to produce, so I ended up having to pull the whole thing down, fix this, and re-upload it. So the export takes about half an hour, but the upload, because my internet connection is not great, the upload takes probably about 7 hours or so, with another 2 or 3 hours for the video to be processed on YouTube's end, server-side. So that's 10, 11 hours just getting the video from Premiere to YouTube. And I had to do that all over again after the video went live. But what you all did not see was that I had to re-upload it probably another at least 3, I think maybe 4 times, because once I finished the actual editing, I then had to submit the video to the staff at the Harney & Sons store in Millerton for review. Because if I'm going to have them in it, if they're going to be answering questions on camera, I'm not going to upload it without first giving them a chance to review it and provide their feedback to let me know whether everything that involved them in the footage is okay for me to show. And again, that's just another professional courtesy. It's the sort of thing that really ends up being my responsibility to know enough to do it for them, because nobody at the Harney & Sons store is going to have the kind of experience in video production necessary to know that they'll need to ask me to let them review what I upload first. And had I failed to do that, it would have not only been very unprofessional, but uploading the video without having them review it could potentially have led to some misinformation being published or other more disastrous results if something that I had said was for some reason injurious to their business. So what I ended up doing was uploading the video with an unlisted link several times, sending it to them each time, letting them review it, and then hearing their feedback, following which I would change the video according to the feedback they provided, re-upload it, send it to them again, and the process would repeat as many times as it took to get the video to the point where they were no longer catching any errors, nothing else looked like it needed to be changed, and everything looked above board and it was basically ready to publish. But another very important part of the editing process is balancing the audio levels. And that's probably one of the most, if not the most, annoying and painstaking parts of editing any video. And I've talked about this in the 2-hour explanation of the overall editing process, but getting the right audio levels so that my voice commentary is not drowned out by the music and vice versa is a very difficult proposition. And there were certain points I think I had to do it with the, yeah, you can see here, maybe I should zoom this out a little bit so it's a little clearer, but you can see some keyframes in the Dire Dire Docs track here and here, where I had to actually individually adjust the audio level in a certain part of this track because it got too loud here, but was just about the right volume before and after. I then have to individually adjust audio levels for each track so that the contents of those tracks are of the right levels that everybody can hear everything clearly without one thing overpowering another. And even still, I always get complaints from somebody whose speakers are just the wrong model and play the audio in such a way that it is not balanced no matter what I do. So this is just something that it's a perpetually losing battle, and no matter how much time I spend on it and how much care I put into it, somebody always complains. It's just, I tear my hair out trying to achieve the best audio balance I possibly can, but it's one of those elusive, it's like a red herring almost. I feel like perfect audio balance almost doesn't exist. But another thing I had to do was, when there were points in the video that did need to be corrected, in a couple of cases, one of the staff from the Harney & Sons store ended up recording and sending me voice clips of their own to patch in over the existing audio. And that was another thing that took time. I had to actually delete the background audio from the video itself and take audio from elsewhere in the video where it was just background noise from the store. I had to patch that in over the existing audio at that point in the clip so that it sounded natural and there was actual background noise from the shop, so that it didn't sound like all of a sudden the video is playing, the store background noise is there, and then everything just goes quiet and you hear one person saying a few lines of dialogue. In order to prevent that from happening, I had to use background noise from elsewhere in the video to create the illusion that it was seamless, and then patch in the voice audio from the staff member on top of that. And this was a very precise technique. And for those of you who did watch the actual episode, I would venture to suggest that probably very few, if any of you, even noticed this, and I bet most of you wouldn't have noticed it had I not pointed it out here. But that was a fairly tough consideration as well. And I mentioned before using the tins of tea to cover people's faces. That was another thing. I actually had to do motion tracking animation with these tins in the situations where they needed to follow somebody's face, like they're doing now. And yes, guys, I do realize that the picture in the background here did have a reflection and that you could vaguely see some faces in it from time to time, but it was so fuzzy and so indistinct that it really wasn't even worth trying to censor. I think there was one occasion, it might actually have been, yes, it was right here. This was the only instance in which somebody's face was clear enough in the reflection that I went to the trouble of covering it up. And I did realize that, and I did take a particular amount of care when I realized that the reflection was showing people's faces, but you really can't see anything on any of the other occasions when this is the case, so I didn't bother. The same is also true for my reflection in the teapot at the beginning of the episode. I know a couple of people did notice that, but I didn't bother covering it up because it's such a fuzzy reflection, you really can't see any more in that than you can in the channel update videos when I actually appear in person on camera, just wearing my hat and coat. So that's that, but the motion tracking for these images, a lot of time and care went into that as well, and let me just zoom in here a bit so that I can show the actual keyframes for one of these. We'll highlight this, and you'll see, I don't know if it will let me zoom in or not, it doesn't really look like it wants to, but you can see all of these little diamonds here. Each one is an individual keyframe that designates a point of animation for this image of a tin of tea. And I had to go through and do this frame by frame in probably, I think there are 9 or 10 times in this video when I had to cover up people's faces. And that's a lot of motion tracking that's it just really very time consuming. So that's another thing that goes into the amount of time it takes to produce these videos. And I think that's mostly it. But again, it's something that I don't think a lot of people really realize. When you watch the video, it's like a 43-minute video. To watch that, you wouldn't know that 6 weeks of work went into it. And another thing is that the videos I make, which require more than a single day's worth of editing, they often go on for a long time just because I have to chip away at them in my spare time, and I can't sit down and finish them in one editing session. So between the time that I had to spend just finding all of the stuff I needed to make this, like the music, and then dividing it up across my free time over 6 weeks. And in addition to that, I still have to make other videos while I'm working on this so that you guys have something else to watch. I mean, I was not only producing this in the process of doing the editing and various other parts of production, but I was sitting down and recording episodes of Far Cry 4, Salt and Sanctuary, and doing all of the various other things that I have to do on a daily basis, you know, cooking meals, going to work, working on Salt and Sanctuary with James and Michelle, and trying my best to put in an appearance in some streams with Nick and Plague and Frosty and Dropout and Cranky and whoever else happened to be involved on that particular day. So just having a life is an impediment to my being able to produce these videos on anything like the level of frequency that I wish I could. And again, I really hate plugging things like Patreon and donations, but those are an important part of my being able to make these videos as well. Sometimes I can get away with making an episode of Tea Talk without having to spend money, and I do my very best to make them on a budget. Something like showing my own collection of tea, talking about some of my favorite types of tea, what I recommend, that kind of thing. Something that I can record without leaving the house. Yeah, that doesn't tend to cost too much money. But unfortunately, anything more elaborate than that, and anything that requires me to show something like tea snacks, for example, or that requires me to actually go out and purchase something that I don't already have on hand, that all costs money. And especially travel. If I actually have to travel somewhere to record an episode of Tea Talk, that costs money as well. And I don't want to sound like I don't appreciate what I'm already earning on Patreon, because I absolutely do. It's crucial. And at this point, most of it is going to just helping me make ends meet, unfortunately. I wish that I could spend more of it on producing these videos. But if I had something like $2,000 or $3,000 or $4,000 a month coming in, I would travel around the world regularly just to make videos. That's something that I very much want to do. But unfortunately, right now, I can't afford to do that. And even what I'm earning on Patreon is, it's not as much as my Patreon page says it is, partly because Patreon takes a cut, but also partly, and I think this is people with the best of intentions whose hearts are bigger than their wallets. But a significant portion of the money that people have actually pledged on Patreon, those transactions have been declined or otherwise failed. And I suspect that this is people offering me more than they actually have to offer, which I freaking told you guys not to do. Don't give me more than you have. I appreciate that you'd even consider throwing any amount of money at me in the first place. But by the time all is said and done, my last payout from Patreon was just under $700, when I think as of recording this video, it's showing something more like $840, $850. So just so that everybody is aware, resources are a consideration, and as much as I hate talking about them, I can't avoid the fact that they're a thing. So any contributions that anybody feels like making will definitely help me produce episodes of Tea Talk more frequently. And that, I think, just about covers everything. This video has already gone on far longer than I intended. So thank you all for joining me. I hope somebody has found this enjoyable and enlightening. And I look forward to seeing all of you next time. Take care, everybody.